This week on Maker Update, a workstation set to exterminate, a boat powered by ionic thrust, how to use an oscilloscope, tool organization, space fishing, and cracking the code of QWOP. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. I'm deep in the work of a project that I hope I'll get to share with you really soon. And hopefully you've got something propelling you forward as well. We've got another great show for you, so let's kick it off with the project of the week. Sometimes you get a call to build one of those projects. The one where you get to build something absolutely outrageous. And when it's built, you just know it's going to go to a very happy client. That's what happened to Jeremy Fielding in his latest build, where he's constructing this Doctor Who-themed CAD workstation, and he's building it for a recipient in the Magic Wheelchair program. He didn't have to worry about the design, just the fabrication. But that's when they dropped the other shoe. He needed to deliver this thing in just over 2 months. Building structural elements is right in Jeremy's wheelhouse, but these wild curves and delicate features are something else for him entirely. His first pass over the design was to remove some extraneous features to make the design a little more practical. One element that he just couldn't let go of were these tentacles coming out of the Daleks. They probably couldn't be used as actual supports for the arms of the desk, but he just couldn't bear the thought of getting rid of them. They're just too cool. After a whole lot of welding, cutting, machining, and gluing, the basic structure was starting to come together. And as the 3D parts were coming off the print beds, the original design was taking shape as well. But to make this one really come to life, Jerry called in the help of Brian from the Smuggler's Room. There's a whole other video about this build on his channel about the painting and finishing of the desk. Also, I love the detail of adding magnetic breakaways to the arms of the Daleks, since it's possible that Jenica will eventually bump into these and damage them. Now, they'll just break away cleanly and snap back on. That's cool. When the delivery day finally came, Jeremy was more than happy to do the final install, and Jenica couldn't be happier with the final result. This thing is just friggin' cool looking. And it's such a rare treat to have the excuse to build something like this, and a testament to the skill and craft of everyone involved. More projects. From the Plasma channel, I found this video on building a mini catamaran powered by ionic thrust. As futuristic as it sounds, ionic thrust has been around for a long time, and you can build a thruster with basic plumbing parts. But if you have the know-how, you can build a more impressive one using modern 3D printing technologies and good design. One of my favorite tips from this video is that he's using a transformer from a stun gun. They're pretty easy to get your hands on, and they're a reliable way to turn 5 volts into 40,000. That's just one of the catches for ionic thrusters. You need really high voltage to make it work. Of course, this isn't all clever tech for the sake of being clever. While powered sea travel was a revelation for humanity, it hasn't been great for marine life. The noise generated by powered propellers has been a huge detriment for all types of sea life. Ionic thrusters are completely silent, and while their thrust output is still fairly low, the technology is still in its infancy. The field test of this catamaran was a success. It's not going to break any speed records, but it's cool to see this coming together for the future. Trying to impress your friends with 3D printing is maybe one of the most difficult challenges with the technology, which is why I'm constantly impressed with the efforts of Devin Montez of Make Anything to use 3D printing in his exploration of game design. This fishing game is based on a game he used to play with his mother, just modernized. Each fishing pole has a strong magnet used to catch a metal washer embedded into each of the 3D printed fish. Devin's video is a wonderful iteration on his design process, starting from his original all 3D printed design to the final fishing rod. Devin has published all the files if you want to print up your own game of space fishing. Check out the links down in the description. And finally, the Ruiz brothers just dropped this 3D printed Ultrahand cosplay prop from The Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom. At first glance, this looks like a fairly straightforward 3D printed prop using LED noodles for lighting. But what really caught my attention was their leveraging of the parametric design features of Fusion 360. Since everybody's body is different, the ability to adjust the spacing and diameter of these rings really makes this one a slam dunk. Time for some tips and tools. I'll admit, I have no idea how to use an oscilloscope. That's probably why I've always excused myself out of buying one. Zack Freedman's latest video demystifies the differences between multimeters, logic analyzers, and oscilloscopes. And that's when he explains the deceptive simplicity of these workbench tools. Zack explains how to understand what the scope is telling you, what to do with that data, and when the errors are caused by the probe itself. Izzy Swan has been taking a new approach to tool organization in his workshop, and there's a ton of interesting ideas here. Of course, tool and shop organization is one of those super personal topics, and everyone has their own approach. For Izzy, accessibility is a key factor, and there's a ton of interesting considerations here. He's using Kaizen foam inserts to organize his tools in tool chests, but the trays could also easily drop right into these rolling carts for direct accessibility at the work area. Over on Adafruit, I found this guide by Anne Barela on using circuit design software to make jewelry. It's been more times than I care to admit that I've attempted to learn circuit design software only to become overwhelmed and run away screaming. Anne's guide gives you permission to learn the software with a less critical approach. Using the contrast between the copper plate and the solder mask, and just making cool designs. As you level up, you can add in simple circuit elements like LEDs to make your design come to life. Anne's guide works as a primer for KiCad, Gingerbread, and Affinity Designer. And finally, the latest episode of the FOSSPod features an interview with Lucas Arakinski about the open source and open hardware work of Pine64. These folks are making all sorts of open source tools for makers, including my favorite soldering iron. This podcast episode serves as a wonderful primer to the company and their approach to projects. And if you haven't heard of the FOSSPod before, this is a podcast specifically dedicated to free and open source software projects and products. Be sure to check out their past episodes on Raspberry Pi, Inkscape, Blender, Octoprint, and even VLC. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, Shawn, Hymel is answering a question that probably no one is asking. Can machine learning learn to play QWOP? If you're unfamiliar, QWOP is a game that tasks you with navigating a sprinter over the finish line. But your controls are the specific thigh and calf muscles of the runner's legs. Shawn breaks down the basics of how to train the neural network to learn its objectives. It's a cool breakdown. Check it out. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, please tell us about it down in the comments, and give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe at the bell so you don't miss the next one. As always, huge thanks to DigiKey for making the show possible, and to you for watching. Take care, we'll see you soon.